JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for August the 14th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the US dollar traded mixed against the other G10 currencies on Thursday and during the Asian morning Friday. It gained against NZD, AUD, SEC and JPY in that order, while it underperformed versus NOK, CAD and CHF. The greenback was found nearly unchanged against the euro and the British pound. The weakening of the commodity-linked currencies Aussie and Kiwi suggests that risk appetite softened again, but the fact that the yen was also among the losers suggests otherwise. Thus, in order to get a clearer picture with regards to the broader market sentiment, we prefer to turn our gaze to the equity world. Here, major EU indices were a sea of red, with the FTSE 100 sliding the most due to an early jump in the pound, as well as declines in AstraZeneca, BP, and GlaxoSmithKline, which traded without entitlement to a dividend payout. The negative morale rolled over into the US session, but much softer, perhaps due to a larger than expected decline in the initial jobless claims for last week. Both the Dow Jones and the S&P 500 slid 0.29% and 0.20% respectively, with the latter hovering near its all-time peak, but Nasdaq was up 0.27%, perhaps as investors prefer to turn back to markets that have remained resilient during the pandemic crisis, like the technology sector. Sentiment improved somewhat during the Asian session today, with Japan's Nikkei, China's Shanghai Composite and Hong Kong's Hang Seng gaining 0.11, 0.41 and 0.27% respectively. The exception was South Korea's KOSPI, which tumbled 1.22% as South Korean authorities reported the largest number of new coronavirus infections since March. On top of that, what may have also prompted some investors to liquidate their positions may have been the fact that the Trump administration and Congress Democrats in the US remain deadlocked over a new coronavirus aid bill. Following the new flare-up in tensions between the US and China, investors may have also been nervous due to tomorrow's talks between top officials with regards to the Phase 1 trade accord agreed between the two nations. With that in mind, we repeat that for investors to increase their risk exposures again, US Democrats and Republicans may have to agree over a new fiscal package, and US and Chinese officials may need to provide encouraging remarks over their nation's trade relationship. Now back to the currencies, the Kiwi and the Aussie were the main losers, actually, as apart from the overall risk of trading, RBNZ's chief economist Yong Ha and RBA's governor Philip Lowe stated that they would prefer a weaker local currency. Our view remains that as risk-linked currencies, the direction of both is likely to stay mostly dependent on developments surrounding the broader market sentiment. However, with the RBNZ expanding its bond purchases this week and opening further the door to negative interest rates, we expect the Kiwi to continue underperforming its Australian counterpart. In other words, we expect Aussie Kiwi to continue drifting north. Remember that in contrast with the RBNZ, the RBA has repeatedly said that 0.25% is the effective lower bound of its benchmark interest rate. Now, as for today's events, during the European morning, Eurozone's employment change and the second estimate of the bloc's GDP, both for the second quarter, are coming out. No forecast is currently available for the employment change, while the second GDP estimate is expected to confirm the initial forecast of -12.1% quarter over quarter. Later from the US, we get the retail sales for July, industrial production for the same month, and the preliminary University of Michigan Consumer Sentiment Index for August. Both headline and core sales are forecast to have slowed to 1.8% month over month and 1.6% month over month from 7.5% and 7.3% respectively, while industrial production is anticipated to have slowed to 3% month over month from 7.2%. The University of Michigan Consumer Sentiment Index is expected to have declined fractionally to 72 from 72.5. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 7 o'clock a.m. GMT time. That said, at this point, I have to let you know that there will be no weekly Market Outlook webinar on Monday, neither a daily market review video for the rest of the week, for the rest of next week. So goodbye, have a great day, a great weekend, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again on the week starting on August the 24th.
JFT, just fair and direct.